Good morning. Welcome to our services this morning. If you find a seat, grab a hymnal. Stand if you would. Number 462. We'll sing all four verses of Higher Ground, 462. I'm pressing on the upward way, new heights I'm gaining every day. Still praying as I'm onward bound, Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table land, a higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. My heart has no desire to stay where doubts arise and fears dismay. Though some may dwell where these abound, my prayer, my aim is higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table land, a higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. 462 on the third. I want to live above the world, though Satan's darts at me are hurled. For faith has caught the joyful sound, the song of saints on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table land, a higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. I want to scale the utmost height and catch a gleam of glory bright, but still I'll pray till heaven I found. Lord, lead me on to higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table land, a higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground.
Amen. Well, good morning. Good to see all of you out this morning. Had a good men's prayer breakfast this morning, and it was a blessing, and already been fed in two different ways this morning. Good food and good devotion this morning. Brother Aaron, appreciate that, and it's been good already, but we're just getting started. Amen. So let's have a word of prayer, and we'll ask God to bless as we get started here this morning, and then we'll get into a couple of things here before class starts. All right, let's pray. Father, we love you today. Thank you so much for your blessings, Lord. You're so good to us, Lord. Thank you for this last week, and Lord, so many things that we've seen, Lord. We've seen you heal folks that were sick, and we've seen just answered prayers just right and left, Lord. We're just so thankful for that, and thankful that, Lord, that we know that you hear us when we pray, and Lord, that you desire for us to bring our cares and to cast them upon you. Lord, thank you for this morning, for the opportunity to meet together, for the good prayer breakfast we've already had. And Lord, as we get into the Sunday school time here this morning, Lord, we know that all over the building and in every area of the church this morning, there will be your word being opened and taught. And Lord, we just pray that you would just make it powerful, and Lord, just use it to change hearts today, and to, Lord, just affect us in the way that you'd desire. Pray that you'll help us to be attentive to it. And Lord, bless as we continue on through the morning, and then Lord, into our afternoon time at the park. We just pray for your blessings. Help us to be setting good example for those that might be out and around and would see us. And we just thank you for the opportunity just to spend that time of fellowship together. Pray that you'll just bless. And as we begin now this morning, Lord, we just want, right from the beginning, want you to be involved. And Lord, it can't be of us. It needs to be of you. So we pray that you'll do what you desire to do here this morning. And Lord, just that we would step out of the way and let you do what needs to be accomplished here, because only you can accomplish what you desire. So I pray that you'll just work today. Bless now as we get started, in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, go ahead and be seated. Couple of different things that we'll mention here this morning. First and foremost, pick up a bulletin. They're in the back there. Be sure that if you haven't gotten one, that you grab one this morning and take with you, because September is a busy month, and there's a lot in here, and I'm not going to go over everything. Particularly, I want to just mention this morning the annual church picnic. Hope that you will come out and be a part of the picnic today, and as soon as we're done with the morning service, we'll go out to Main Park. If you need directions to Main Park, let me know, and can let you know how to get there. I think the best way to say it is to go back up here to Eastman, go all the way to First Street, and go turn right, and you'll run right into it. It's not very far away at all, but we're going to have a good time today. Always do when we have our picnic. We just pray the rain holds off, which it looks like it's going to, but we'll have a good time, eat some food, and have our afternoon service out there, and then just have the rest of the time for playing around at the park and fellowship and those types of things. So hope you come be a part of that. Always a blessed time. The other thing I'll mention is this week will be the September 14th. That's this coming Tuesday. Do you believe it's already the middle of the month? Good night. September 14th will be the next ladies' meeting. It'll be right here at the fellowship hall in the church. And so I don't see any of them in here that are part of it. If you're part of my discipleship class, we will not be meeting on Tuesday because of that. So I'll mention that later, and the ones that will be involved will be there. Anyway, ladies' meeting, 6:30 on Tuesday, right here in the fellowship hall. September 18th, that's next Saturday, will be our next Lions Blitz. We had a good crowd out yesterday with several from here and others from Longmont that came out to be a part. Next Saturday, have another opportunity. It'll be the same time, same place, meeting the same place, and basically doing the same thing. We're going to hopefully get the remainder of Lions done, which shouldn't take too long, and then hopefully get into a little bit of hygiene area tomorrow as well. Not that you don't have good hygiene already, but hygiene the town, okay? Got to explain these things sometimes. Anyway, I'll be getting into that and working, because next Sunday is going to be the first official Sunday of Lighthouse Baptist Church of Lyons. And they're going to be starting in their new facility there, and we want to get the word out as much as we can. So I encourage you, please come out and help if you can. There's a sign-up sheet on the back table just so we know how many to plan for, and food-wise and things like that. So please sign up if you're going to come and be a part of that. Okay, if you're taking notes, I got a couple of announcements that are not in the bulletin that you may need to write down. First off, this one you need to write down. Well, if you're a lady, you need to write this down. Secret Sisters is starting up here pretty quick. Forms need to be completed and returned to Jody Wade no later than September 26th. And you can see Miss Jody for questions if you have any questions, okay? So ladies, Secret Sisters, get with Miss Jody. We'll be announcing it, but I believe the forms are available now. So if you don't have one, see her about that, get a form, and be a part of that. That's always a blessing for the ladies. Now, these things are really particular for today, these next two. Number one, if you brought items for the picnic, food, and it's in the fridge back here, don't leave without it, okay? There's not going to be anybody that's going to be in charge of picking up all the food that's been brought in and bringing it out to the park. If you brought it in, please grab it and take it also to the park, okay? We have the food that the church is providing, and we will be making sure that that gets out there. But everything else you need to take, if you brought it, please be sure to take it or arrange for it to be taken out to the park. Secondly, and this is a little, I guess we've learned from experience, we have cameras in the church now. For those of you who don't know, every room, every classroom and main room where people are assembling will have a camera in it. And there's several reasons that we do that now. But that makes it a little bit of an issue when there are people who want to change clothes to go out to the park. All right, you understand what I'm saying? Don't go in a classroom and close the door and think you're going to be alone. And okay, I'm just saying, we had a little incident last year and realized that, oh, that could be an issue. Bathrooms, okay, no cameras in the bathrooms. Go in there, use those. The rest of the classrooms and things will have a camera in them. Now, I will tell you this. There is a camera in the storage room that's right off back here, you know, the one at the end of the hall. There is a camera in there, but it's not working. It's not hooked up. So if you want to use that one, you can use that room as well. Just be careful if you go to change clothes that you're not doing it in front of a working camera. So, all right, one more thing I want to mention here this morning. We just don't want anybody to be embarrassed. You know, it was kind of embarrassing last year, and we just want to be sure that you recognize that. Just got a message. A lot of prayer requests. We all have a lot of prayer requests, and we've been praying for a lot of people with COVID. I just got a word this morning that missionaries in the Philippines, John Quinlan, is it John? Is that right? John Quinlan is very, very sick with COVID. He's in the hospital there in the Philippines. Now, we don't support these missionaries, but I know who they are, and the Onlys have supported them for years and are good friends with them, and many of you may know who they are. But whether you do or not, that's a missionary that's on the field there in the Philippines, and we'd be good if we'd pray for him as well. So if you want to write down John Quinlan, just pray for him this week as you have your prayer time. We'd encourage you to do that. All right. I think that is it.
Stand again, if you would, number 236. 236. Whosoever heareth, shout the sound. Spread the blessed tidings all the world around. Tell the joyful news wherever man is found. Whosoever will may come. Whosoever will, whosoever will. Send the proclamation over vale and hill. 'Tis the loving Father calls the wanderer home. Whosoever will may come. Whosoever cometh need not delay. Now the door is open, enter while you may. Jesus is the truth, the only living way. Whosoever will may come. Whosoever will, whosoever will. Send the proclamation over vale and hill. 'Tis the loving Father calls the wanderer home. Whosoever will may come. Whosoever will, the promise is secure. Whosoever will, forever must endure. Whosoever will, 'tis life forevermore. Whosoever will may come. Whosoever will, whosoever will. Send the proclamation over vale and hill. 'Tis a loving Father calls the wanderer home. Whosoever will may come.
Thank you. You may be seated.
Good morning. He can't run a soundboard, but he makes mean sausage nuggets. Men's prayer breakfast was awesome this morning. So good to see the room fill up. The food was good. I'm assuming it smelled good in there. I don't know. Still can't smell anything. So weird. Like, your nose has two functions, really, to smell and to move air in and out. It does the one. The other one, nothing. Let's read a verse to kind of reground ourselves in what we're teaching about here. We'll have a word of prayer, and then we'll jump into it. The verse that we're basing the overall principle on is Luke chapter 6, verse 38. And for we have some royalty visiting us, so we will kind of talk real quick that this book that we've been working through is called It's Not What You Think, and it's about how God's mindset of how he approaches things in ours are often quite different, almost polar opposites. This lesson is called Given It Shall Be Given, Not Take and Keep All You Can, which is what the human default setting is. Luke 6:38 says, Given it shall be given unto you, good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, shall men give into your bosom. For with the same measure that ye meet withal, it shall be measured to you again. Lord, we just thank you for the Sunday school hour. Just looking forward to a fun day for the church family. And help us not to get distracted with the festivities of later, but just to pay attention to the preaching and the teaching this morning, and just help us to glean from your word. And just bless the Sunday school hour now in Jesus' name. Amen. Yeah, again, men's prayer breakfast, if it's not your habit to come, you missed out this morning. Aaron did a great job, and Dave and I were having this discussion about we had kind of some of these mind-blowing experiences. This morning, these young men are just amazing. Aaron did a great job, and Ben had a very thoughtful prayer request this morning, and I was just like, who is that? It was seeing Benjamin draw those names. You know, my kid did that when he was that big. He's in college now. My tradition is to grow my goatee in the fall. It's about this color now, so I don't know how much longer we'll do that. Kind of a great age revealer. But just a great morning. So we've been working through this idea of given it shall be given unto you, and we were comparing. You know, we're getting this direction from a source that we can't argue with. Christ gave his life, so he knows a little bit something about giving. Not only that, through him giving his life, we got the gift of salvation. And we talked a lot about the difference between getting and receiving and all these other things last week. And we think that there's somehow, because again, it's our own human mindset, that there's a limit to giving. Like, I can give, but to a point. God illustrated to you that there should be no limit to your giving. He gave his son. Christ gave his life. Top that. Like, if that's the bar that you're supposed to push towards, anything short of that is by our own limitation. And he gave us salvation. The next point is that he gave us security. One of the biggest dividing rods between a belief system that we have that is scripturally based and ones that seem very similar to ours, but may have one or two distinct differences, and one of them is eternal security. You're just not going to convince me that I can lose my salvation. It's not going to happen. I understand in the human mind why you might think that that's how you would do it if you were God. I'm glad you're not him, because that's not what the Bible teaches. After he saves us, he seals us with the Holy Spirit. He preserves us until the day of redemption. It's just, and you're like, well, what if I completely go off the rails and I do this and this and this, and you go down this list of ugly, dastardly things? Yeah, those people too. And again, that's not how we would do it. We'd be like, oh, you need to earn your way back into God's good graces. You know, you can do that in about a nanosecond with the thought of, Lord, I'd like to be back in your good graces. What do I have to do? In a world that where change is constant and people change frequently and their attitudes change, I can be 15 different people between the time I wake up and 10 o'clock in the morning. Just depends when you catch me. I got so much stuff running through my heart and my mind. That's not God. That's not our God. He's not that way. He is a constant, and he promises us eternal security. We'll go over some verses just to ground ourselves in this. Ephesians 4:30, and grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby ye are sealed unto the day of redemption. Done. Thank you. Why, of all the things in the Bible that you would argue with, why would you pick something so amazing as eternal security and you would pick that apart, something that's to your own detriment, even if it was true, which it's not? Why would you attack that? Why would you create that vulnerability in a Christian's life? Why would you do that? I don't see the motivation for that. Just think about it in the smallest realm. If you have a child and you give them a gift and you say, at any time I can take that away from you, you know, this is yours, I'm giving it to you, it is your possession, but at any time I can come just take it. They're gonna not use it the same way. They may hide it. They may, you know, it's just that constant thought that I'm enjoying it, but I can't fully enjoy it because mom or dad may just come take it at any time. I can't fully maximize the use of it because I'm worried about it being taken away. If you believe you can lose your salvation, that's how you live your life. You can't ever fully enjoy it. And Pastor alluded to this last Sunday. I think it was Sunday. And he's got a friend. He's like, okay, you're on the spot. Right now, are you saved? I don't know. If someone asks you that question and you say, I don't know, you're not saved. If you really don't know, now I'm not going to say you're never going to have these thoughts creep into your mind and you're never going to question your salvation and I can give you a 5-point checklist to check to see if you're saved. But if you're like, oh, I don't know, like right now, I mean, I was earlier today, but right now I don't know. Romans 8:38 and 39, for I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor the height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. You don't think God knew man was going to try to mess this up? Think about this list. What if a tiger takes my salvation? No, I put creatures in there. Like, it's like everything I can think that you're going to try to dream up, some other power, some other ruling entity in your life is going to take your salvation. I don't know, powers, principalities. Well, what if one of God's own creatures takes it from me? Angels? Like, what else can you come up with? How do you have the audacity to challenge that verse and try to convince people from God's sacred desk, the pulpit, that they can lose their salvation? That's a control thing. That is man trying to control another man. And you better do what I say, and you better do it the way I want it. You want to do all these things, because if you don't, you can lose your salvation. And you better give like you should, and you better be in church like you should, all these things. Do those things, but don't do it because of the fear of losing your salvation. It's not a thing. You need this peace to have the stability that you need to be able to do some of the things that God asks you to do from a right heart. Because otherwise, you're going to be doing it from the simple motivation of, if I don't do it, I'm going to lose my salvation. And the results are not the same. Well, I've had periods in my life where I've been closer to God and further away from God. There's been times in my life where I felt like I just could not arrest God's attention and all of that. You moved, He didn't. I've been there. I've had that experience. And I can tell you that when you do the direct, deep heart analysis of the matter, you moved, He didn't. And you can be 1,000 miles away from God in your heart, and you can turn and take one step, and He's right there. But as long as you're facing the polar opposite direction, it's going to be pretty far away, and it's going to feel that way. If our relationship with God changes, that's on us, not on Him. His promises will never fail us, and He's trustworthy because His record is like a gazillion to zero. There is promises that God has made you that are yet unfulfilled, but that does not mean that they won't happen, and that doesn't mean that it's not true. We get into this pity party sometime about Christ delaying his return. Well, the people on the other side of it were having a pity party that he wasn't showing up. So we're going to be upset about something anyway. Some of you are going to be upset when he shows up that you think the timing's bad. Now, really? I finally got a little bit of this figured out. Shh, and go. Because if you slow it down for me, somewhere between here and there, we're having words. Malachi 3:6, for I am the Lord, I change not. Therefore, ye sons of Jacob are not consumed. You know why you're not consumed? Because I told you you wouldn't be. That's the only reason why. Don't change my mind on that. Just because God is sovereign doesn't mean he can't change his mind. Because there's many biblical examples where he's like, okay. You know what those are? All of them? Grace and mercy. Please don't destroy them. Okay, you find a couple hundred people and I won't. And it gets down to, find one. James 1:17, something that I circled in my Bible when I was a very, very, very new Christian. Every good gift, every perfect gift is from above, cometh down from the Father of lights, with whom is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. That really spoke to me because I spent a lot of time outside, and I just thought of, if you are outside at any time of day, even when the sun is directly over you, you cast a shadow because you are between the sun and the ground, so it's casting a shadow. And when you look at how some professional studio photography is done, or if you see these big photo shoots and it looks all natural, and then you see how they do that, and all the screens and reflectors and all that stuff it takes. The reason why it's significant to talk about the shadows and the lack of variableness is God's light is so perfect that there's no flaw in it. There's no shadows. So if there's a shadow that's being cast, it's being cast by what? By you. It's God's light's not doing it. It's you're in the way. So he gives us salvation, he gives us security, and he also gives us sustenance, which is really hard not to say that like Sylvester the cat, because if you've ever heard him say sustenance, I didn't spit over my book too much. Turn in your Bibles, if you will, to Jeremiah chapter 14. You know, it's interesting when I've talked about this before, and if you've ever done these type of things, when you get something on your heart and mind and you're studying something out, then it seems like everything else you read pertains to that. And so this was just in our Bible reading this week. If you're doing the Bible reading schedule that the church put out. And it's this idea of God gives his sustenance. Verse 22, if you will. There's kind of this debate going on, and there's this idea of where do things come from? Are there any among the vanities of the Gentiles that can cause rain, or can the heavens give showers? Art not thou he, O Lord our God? Therefore will he wait upon thee, for thou hast made all these things. You cannot conjure up the sustenance that should come from God. You can't make a sunrise or a sunset or a rainbow. You can't make it cloudy. You can't make it rain. You can't grow the tree that you're going to sit under the shade of out at the picnic later. Those things come from God. And his fact check here, he's like, hey, all these guys doing all this crazy stuff, can any of them make it rain? Do you realize how many billions and billions of dollars have been spent over the world's life experience of man trying to figure out how to make it rain? They're still working on this. Cloud seeding, all these things that they try to do to make it rain, to break up a drought. Can't do it. Seems like a pretty simple thing. It's the water cycle. Go back to earth science class and whatever grade that was. Created by God to sustain his planet. Can't mess with it. You can't cause a drought and you can't cause a flood. God can do both of them at the same time in places that are like an hour away from each other. With the life that God's given us, he supplies us what we need to live. Some of us have just lived in the first world for so long. You know, you're like, oh, back when I was really poor, I ate a lot of ramen noodles. My son's cereal shopping in college now. And he's like, hey, Mom, it's not this cereal, but it's this cereal. And it was like 42 cents cheaper. I'm like, oh, the poverty of you having to choose the slightly less expensive cereal. My son is also an expert on regional gas prices if you're anywhere and never need to know how much fuel is. He can tell you that one obscure gas station that's like 5 cents cheaper. It's a weird hobby, I know. First Timothy 6:17, charge them that are rich in this world that they be not high-minded, nor trust in certain riches, but in the living God who giveth us richly all things to enjoy. Hey, all that stuff you got, don't be too arrogant about it. Philippians 4:19, but my God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. God also meets our spiritual needs. We need to be real careful teaching this lesson and think it's all about stuff. A word that guides us, reveals us, his promises to us, the way he nourishes our soul. Verses like Psalm 119, 116. Uphold me according unto the word that I may live and not be ashamed of my hope. That verse really stopped me in my tracks because I was like, what exactly am I saying there? What am I to think? And it's kind of like, God, if I do as you've instructed, please let it work. Like, if I do this, could you please let it work? Can I see it work? He's like, well, you got to do it first before you find out. Jeremiah 15:16, not too far from where your Bible might still be open. Thy words were found, and I did eat them, and thy word was unto me the joy and rejoicing of my heart, for I am called by the name, O Lord God of hosts. His word can sustain you. In a season of trial, and we talked a lot about that for a few weeks, God gives special grace to sustain us and give us strength through what seemed like unsurmountable difficulty sometimes. Psalm 15:22, a lot of people have that memorized. 55:22, cast thy burden upon the Lord, and he shall sustain thee. He shall suffer the righteous. He will never suffer the righteous to be moved. So he gives us salvation, security, sustenance, and satisfaction. This is where we often mess it up in short term and sometime in long periods of our life. There is a vacuum in your life that can only be filled by God, can only be filled by your relationship with Christ. And we try to stuff so many other things in this void in our life to find some periods of temporary happiness. And we build bridges to happiness and happiness and happiness and happiness. And we just, we do these ridiculous, if I can just get through next week. If I can just get through this. Some of you are like, if we could just get through the picnic. If we can just get through our revival. You know, it's like the busy times. It's finals week. It's your quarterly reporting. However that hits you at the workplace. You're like, if I can just get through this. Life's going to get better. It is the biggest lie we tell ourselves as adults every single day. And Aaron Cast will tell you it's never going to get better. Just look forward to the day you die. It's pretty much what we talked about at men's prayer breakfast this morning. Don't pursue your own death. But just realize that that's how it's supposed to be. But the peace and the way that you cope with all that is not if I can just make it to the beach vacation or the cruise, those things are wonderful, and I'm going to go have a great weekend, but that's not, there's a lot of miserable people at the beach too. Trust me, I arrest some of them. Unlike the fleeting happiness that the world offers, you can get actual satisfaction from your relationship with Christ. And we can keep coming back for that, and it'll never run out of supply. Psalm 145:16, thou openest thine hand and satisfieth the desire of every living thing. Psalm 21:2, thou hast given him his heart's desire and hast not withholden the request of his lips, Selah. Psalm 37:4, delight thyself also in the Lord, and he shall give thee the desires of thine heart. There's an order of operations there that we mess up. We're like, I want the desires of my heart. Well, you're not going to manifest those yourself. You can give that illusion in other, you see that illusion happening in other people's life because they got the toys or they got this or they got that. Some of the wealthiest people I know are equally the most miserable people I know. And they just keep trying to stuff things in there. You want the desires of your heart? Delight yourself in the Lord first. I didn't write it. Again, the title of this series is It's Not What You Think. I'm like, I don't like that system. It doesn't matter if you like it or not. Psalm 16:11. Thou wilt show me the path of my life. In thy presence is fullness. In thy presence is the fullness of joy. At thy right hand there are pleasures forevermore. Think about the heart that was written from. Just show me, because as long as I'm in your presence, that's what fills my heart, Lord. You know, we always talk about, you know, the kids being far away from home. And, you know, I think I probably worried, worry's a strong word, was more concerned about Rachel being so far away than I am Jake. It's just a daughter-son thing. You'll have to forgive me for thinking that way. But I always told everyone, they're like, aren't you worried about, I don't know if you know this or not, but Heartland Baptist Bible College is like right in the middle of the hood. It's not, I don't know what you picture if you've ever been there, but it is literally 32 steps away from a trailer park that has random gunfire in it. True story, for those of you who've had that experience. It's not on a nice grassy hill somewhere. And people that, aren't you worried? And we've talked about it. I'm like, I'm glad that certain people in my family have never been there, but I kind of ruined it because they're listening now. But It's not in a great neighborhood. Oh, aren't you worried? And I said, you know what? My daughter's in the center of God's will. I believe that. And that is the safest place you can be. It's when we go walk about from there that the true danger is exposed. And it's not, you know, and that is also means spiritual danger, not just physical danger. I'm at my best when I'm studying and doing this and just immerse myself in this. It brings out some of the best things I have to offer anybody. When we seek contentment in God, we find the pleasures that truly never end. That peace. Just the ability to go to the funeral of a saved person and just be like, man, I'm sad. I'm also kind of jealous that you left me here. It's just to be able to have that peace. The world is never going to give that to you. We talked a lot about that, and the reason why is because if you're going to be a giver, you have to understand the character of God and how it all works. And then that empowers your heart to want to be a giver. When we talk about being a giver, I want to kind of recalibrate our thinking about giving for a second, because I fear that when we talk about giving, that we think of it as some sort of extra thing that we can opt into when we're going through times of blessing in our life. That it's like you get the giver's merit badge. Oh, look, I'm a giver right now. And giving is not some kind of merit badge because you did more than was normally required. So if you're getting a big warm fuzzy about being a giver, that's great. But if you think you're doing it because, oh, look, I've reached this new spiritual level, now I'm a giver, I hate to burst your bubble, but giving is a command. We are to be givers. It is not a, you know what? Oh, man, I got that paid. I'm doing this. Everything's doing good. I think I'm ready to give. If you are waiting to be a giver, it's kind of like waiting to have kids. You're like, oh, we're just not quite ready. Listen, you ain't ever going to be ready for what's about to happen to you, Carla. Just, if you haven't thought about having kids, the younger you have them, the sooner they're out of your house. That's just one way to look at it. That was the Russell and Belinda plan. Married when they're 12, kids out by the time they're 30. How old were you when you got married?
16.
Oh, he was 16, sorry. I'm not even
sure.
I'm not even sure that's legal. Giving is basic, baseline Christian stuff. It's starter kit stuff. It is not some being a giver is not a black belt. It's the white belt. You just from day as soon as you come to this realization you're saved, you're gonna be under conviction about giving. Almost immediately. And that was my experience. And when it gets to that point, you don't necessarily have to train somebody how to give. You can talk to them, and when they get a little nervous about it, say, hey. There are people that give that have never once in their life heard a message on giving. But they've had their heart pounding about it a lot. It's just basic stuff. And I think we think, because when we see philanthropist, but there's another word I was trying to use there, Anthony. philanthropical giving. People that are like, I'm going to have a tax burden. I got so much money, so I need to start a foundation and start giving it out. Like you see that, you know, the, you hear counsel from some of these professional athletes get, they're like, hey, man, the first thing you need to do is start a foundation that you can run and use it as a tax shelter. Okay, giving is not a tax shelter. You should have, you know, and it's like, well, I just don't know why the Lord doesn't bless me. And it's like, that's because you don't give with what you got now. I always think, oh, yeah, if I could just make $5 more an hour, I'd give. If you don't have the heart to give now, it's kind of like you talk to the missionaries. They're like, listen, if you think that there's something about that foreign field or that distant town that you're going to go to that's going to make you care about souls more, that's not a thing. If you're a soul winner, you're a soul winner, and you are witnessing to your neighbors and your coworkers and doing all that, there is nothing magical about the terra firma in Sri Lanka that's going to turn you into someone who cares about souls. And you see these missionaries come through here and they give their presentations, and the ones that you get to spend time with, they are just soul winners. That's just their heart. And they just happen to be called to a specific field. Justin and Carl aren't going to do anything different. You know what is, I'm getting a little annoyed with us here at Windsor Baptist Church. The fact that they're having their first church service next week is a huge deal, people. That is a massive deal. And I won't even include you guys. I don't even know how many thousands of prayers I've had for that, personally. I'm like, spiritually, and I'm trying not to make eye contact with them because I could get very emotional about this topic. It is a big deal. You know why Carla's dad is so geeked up about coming out for Thanksgiving? He's like, I get to go to your church. That's awesome. That is, this church is having a baby church. That's exciting. You guys need to be like, we're spoiled here. We're like, I got Windsor Baptist Church. Well, there's people out there that don't have it, and they don't even have it as an opportunity. It's not that they don't have it because they choose not to go. There is nothing there. Justin told me something. He's like, as far as I know, it's been at a minimum of 15 years since anybody canvassed Lyons, Colorado with an opportunity to hear the gospel in a pamphlet or anything. Think about that. We just get stuff on their door and throw it in the trash. This church has canvassed Windsor, I don't know how many times. At one point, we were doing it once a year, every year. We were hitting every house in town. 15 years. When we give with the right motives, it's not a drudgery, it's a delight. It's, you have to practice. At first, like I was saying, you know, your hand might be shaking when you're writing that check. That gets easier. But it's basic level stuff. It is not like, it is not some sense of arrival. And I feel like that's how it's treated. If you're a Christian and you're not undercover, one of the characteristics that immediately should come to people's mind when they think of you is that you're a giver. Every once in a while, your accountant should go, you know, I think we need to talk about this. Like, it should jump off the page. It should be a characteristic of who you are, that you're a giver. This church put some blessing stuff together for my work crews, and I took it to them, and some of them are just like so blown away. They're like, they're giving us beef jerky and energy drinks? Who does that? I'm like, Christian people do that. You know, there's two factors in particular that will compel you to be a giver, and we'll close with this. And a lot of it's just your love for God and, frankly, just your outlook on life. And if you realize that you are the massive beneficiary of the greatest giver ever, and all you have to do is pay it forward a little bit and just be a giver, be a giver, be a giver, be a giver, be a giver. It's, if they're like, I don't know if that guy's a Christian, he's the most selfish tightwad I've ever met in my life. Yeesh. Should be like, I don't know if he's a Christian or not, but man, that is the most generous person I've ever met. So we will pick up there next week. Just got about 10 minutes till church starts. And if you're waiting to reach some level of giving, you're already there. So let's get busy.
Welcome to Windsor Baptist Church. Grab a hymnal and stand if you're able. Number 653, I Feel Like Traveling On. This wilderness is not our home. We're passing through. And sometimes you just feel like traveling on. Stand if you're able. Number 653. My heavenly home is bright and fair. I feel like traveling on. Nor pain nor death can enter there. I feel like traveling on. Yes, I feel like traveling on. I feel like traveling on. My heavenly home is bright and fair. I feel like traveling on. Its glittering towers, the sun outshines. I feel like traveling on. That heavenly mansion shall be mine. I feel like traveling on. Yes, I feel like traveling on. I feel like traveling on. My heavenly home is bright and fair. I feel like traveling on. On the last. The Lord has been so good to me. I feel like traveling on. Until that blessed home I see, I feel like traveling on. Yes, I feel like traveling on. I feel like traveling on. Heavenly home is bright and fair. I feel like traveling on.
Good singing, remain standing.
Amen. Well, good morning. Good to see all of you out this morning. And boy, we're looking forward to another good day in the Lord's house. I just love to see the attendance just creeping back up as some are able to be back with us. I've been in contact with a couple that are going to be getting back in soon because they're finally getting on the mend and they're feeling better. So sure is good to see the Lord's house starting to get filled back up again after the time that we've been through. It's been difficult. And of course, I know that those of you who have been through it personally, you know, but it's a blessing to see all of you be able to get back. But good to see all of you this morning. Let's have a word of prayer, and we'll get started here this morning and with prayer, and then we'll continue on. Father, we love you today. We thank you for this day. Thank you for the beauty, Lord, of Lord, your creation that you give us. Thank you for the wonderful blessings of the rain and God, just the opportunity to, Lord, just to see you work and manifest yourself in so many ways. And we, Lord, we thank you for your blessings in our lives, for your answered prayer. And Lord, we've seen so many of those in the recent past, even this week. Lord, we just thank you. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to be in your house. And again, Lord, as I've said, just the opportunity to see, Lord, folks be back that have been unable to be with us. And Lord, it's such a blessing to see that. And Lord, thank you for your healing and for your care over us. Lord, we just pray that you will use the service today, Lord, to just accomplish what you desire to accomplish. And I pray this morning that, Lord, as the word is opened up, Lord, that the power that is in the word would be seen, and Lord, the Holy Spirit's work would be felt in hearts today. And Lord, I pray that it would be profitable, and Lord, that nobody would be able to say that as they leave here today that they're leaving the same way that they came in. Lord, change us, and Lord, renew us today. And we pray for your working even of conviction upon our hearts, and Lord, help us to do what you'd have us to do. God, I just pray that you'll bless and everything that is said and done, that you'd be lifted up and glorified today in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, remain standing, please.
Number 654, Oh, I Want to See Him. Feel like traveling on? We've got a good destination, our Lord and Savior.
As I journey through the land, singing as I go, pointing souls to Calvary, to the crimson flow. Many arrows pierce my soul from without within, but my Lord leads me on, through him I must win. Oh, I want to see him, look
upon his face, there to sing forever of his saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Cares all past, home at last, ever to rejoice. When in service for my Lord, dark may be the night, but I'll cling more close to him, he will give me light. Satan's snares may fetch my soul, turn my thoughts aside, but my Lord goes ahead, leads whate'er betide. Oh, I want to see him, look upon his face, there to sing forever of his saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Cares all past, home at last, ever to rejoice. When in valleys low I look toward the mountain height, and behold my Savior there leading in the fight. With a tender hand outstretched toward the valley low, guiding me, I can see as I onward go. Oh, I want to see him, look upon his face, there to sing forever of his saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Cares all past, home at last, ever to rejoice. When before me billows rise from the mighty deep, and he leads me gently on through this world below. He's a real friend to me, oh, I love him so. Oh, I want to see him, look upon his face, there to sing forever of his saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Cares all past, home at last, ever to rejoice.
Good singing.
Seated, if you would. How many of you have ever picked up the hymn book and you've opened it up and you're right on the page that you're supposed to be on? How many have ever done that? Wow, I'm not the only one. Okay, well, picked up the hymn book this morning and I opened up and I looked down to see what the number was and I looked back up and there it was. I was just like, wow. So I thought it was my lucky day, but now I'm not so sure. So. All right, let me give you a couple of announcements this morning. We'll have the men come in just a moment to take up the offering today. But today is our annual church picnic, and if you are here, you are welcome to come and be a part of it. Whether you have signed up or not, we do, I think most everybody has signed up and has brought food, but please come out and we'll have a good time out at the park. For those of you who have never been to it before, here's basically how it works. After the service is over, we'll get all the stuff taken and taken to the park and get everything set up. It'll take a few minutes to get all the tables set up and get the food put out and get the various things going, and then getting the burgers and hot dogs all cooked so that we can eat. And so it'll take a few moments, but by the time everybody gets out there, usually we're pretty close to being ready to go. We'll have lunch out there, and then we'll have a service. We'll have sing a few songs and have a devotion from the Lord's Word, and then we will the remainder of the afternoon will be for just activities out there, fellowship, and just enjoying the time. And hopefully the weather will permit us to be able to do those things. I mentioned this morning I don't have a plan B, so if it rains, I'm not sure what we're going to do. Also, I put Brother Isaiah in charge of the picnic, and so I told him this morning that if it rains, I'm holding him personally responsible. So if you got a problem with that, you go see him, and hopefully the weather will hold. We'll have a good time this afternoon, and hope you come out and join us there. A couple things I want to mention to you, and I don't want to take a long time with the announcements, but a couple things I think need to be mentioned. If you brought food today to take to the park, when we leave here this morning, take it with you to the park, okay? There's not going to be anybody that's going to come around and pick up all the things in the fridge or whatever. We just don't have the capabilities of doing that. So if you brought it, please take it to the park from here as well, so to make sure that it gets there. We'd appreciate that. And certainly appreciate everybody who has signed up and is helping with the food very much. Another thing that I want to mention, I mentioned this this morning in Sunday school, and I just want to be kind of discreet about it, but there are cameras in every classroom, the nurseries. The only ones that there really aren't cameras for the security system are in the bathrooms. So if you change clothes before you go, and many do change your clothes before they go out to the park, please use a room that is not does not have a camera in it, okay? Just don't want anybody to be embarrassed. And we learned last year that is a thing. Hadn't really thought about it, but very well, we better announce it so that people know. Be careful that there's not a, if you use a room, there's not a camera in that, okay? So just be aware of that. So a couple of other things that are coming up here very soon. This week, September 14th, on Tuesday, ladies meeting right here in the fellowship hall. If you are in my discipleship class on Tuesday nights, we will not be having discipleship because of the ladies meeting. So two of them I know are here. If you could make sure that Josh hears that, Miss Sammy, I'd appreciate that. Because it will be ladies meeting here in the fellowship hall on the 14th at 6:30. So ladies, plan for that. September 18th is a church work day in the morning at 9 o'clock. We'll be meeting and just doing some cleaning up, just kind of the fall cleaning time and preparation for the revival that's coming up. And then at 3:30 will be the next Lions Blitz. I encourage you to go. We had a good crowd out yesterday, got a lot accomplished, and we're looking forward to do that one more time. And for those of you who don't know, after next Saturday, we'll do the blitz on Saturday. Next Sunday is the first official service of Lighthouse Baptist Church of Lyons. So come out and join us, and let's get the word out so that as many people know as can possibly know about the services for the church there. And then, of course, be in prayer for Brother Justin as he's preparing everything, and Miss Carla, and that they would just see a great turnout from the area. We know that there are some that are going to go and be a part of the service, and that's a wonderful thing from various churches just to go and support that. But pray that there will be a good group from the area that will show up there, because that's where the church is going to be built from right there. And so please be in prayer for that. If you can come out next Saturday and help us with the Blitz, on the back table back here, there is a sign-up sheet, and you'll sign up on that sheet if you would, just so we know how many are coming. And we look forward to having a good day of getting the word out. That is not everything for the announcements, but I'm not going to tell you anymore. Pick up a bulletin, take it with you, and have that with you, and keep up to date on all the other things that are coming up. They're a little further down the road, but please pick up a bulletin. All right, guys, go ahead and come on forward if you would. I will mention one other thing here while they're coming forward. Secret Sisters is about to start up again. Ladies, you know you enjoy being a part of that, so see Miss Jody and get a form, get that completed out, and get it to Miss Jody by the 26th. Was that 2 weeks from today? Is that right? Yeah, I think that's right. So get that filled out and to her as soon as possible. If you have any questions, please see Miss Jody about that, and she is handling all that, and she'll answer your questions. All right, let's have a word of prayer. Brother John, would you lead us in prayer, please? Thank you.
the hour is approaching when the souls of man will hear a mighty shout resounding in the sky. In power and great glory, King Jesus will appear and take his children home to paradise. It will be a celebration for the ones who chose his name, but total separation for the ones who turned away. Are you ready for the trumpet? Are you ready for the call? Soon the angels will assemble to usher in the Son of God. Will he come and find you faithful? Will he know your name at all? Every moment brings us closer. Are you ready for the call? The Bible speaks of two men who were standing in a field where one is taken and one is left behind. Two women in the kitchen, one goes and one remains. So get your house in order while there's time. In the cross there is salvation. Through the blood there is a way to secure your destination on that resurrection day. Are you ready for the trumpet? Are you ready for the call? Soon the angels will assemble to usher in the Son of God. Will he come and find you faithful? Will he know your name at all? Every moment brings us closer. Are you ready for the call? There's an urgency to reach the world. We have no time to waste. For within the heart of mortal man, the burning question now is raised. Are you ready for the trumpet? Are you ready for the call? Soon the angels will assemble to usher in the Son of God. Will he come and find you faithful? Will he know your name at all? Every moment brings us closer. Are you ready for the call? Will he come and find you faithful? Will he know your name at all? Every moment brings us closer. Are you ready for the call? For the call.
All right, your turn. Oh, I'm sorry. Bible reading, and then your turn.
I was going to say, it's your turn, David, but he didn't. It's all right. Ephesians chapter 2 for our scripture reading this morning, Ephesians chapter 2. And we'll read the first 10 verses this morning for our scripture reading. You all are quiet page turners. All right. Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 1. And you hath he quickened, who were dead in trespasses and sins, wherein in time past ye walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience, among whom also we all had our conversation in times past, in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ. By grace ye are saved, and hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us through Christ Jesus. For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. Amen.
All right, stand once more if you're able. Number 595, Whisper a Prayer. Number 595.
Whisper a prayer in the morning. Whisper a prayer at noon. Whisper a prayer in the evening to keep your heart in tune. God answers prayer.
Sing the first verse again a cappella.
Whisper a prayer in the morning. Whisper a prayer at noon. Whisper a prayer in the evening. So keep your heart in tune.
You may remain standing.
Remain standing, if you would, and get your Bible out this morning. Turn to Romans chapter number 6. Once again, we're getting close to being down to the end of our study in this chapter and move on to chapter 7, but a little bit left here to take care of. Romans chapter 6, we're going to begin reading in verse number 12. We started this portion last week just to kind of get a beginning sense of it, and we'll kind of go back over that just very quickly to refresh our memories on that last week and then get into the next couple of verses. We'll probably, we'll go ahead and read the remainder of the chapter. We'll probably only get through about verse 17 today. But verses 12 through 23 will be our text for this morning. All right, Romans 6, chapter 6 and verse 12. Let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body, that ye should obey it in the lusts thereof. Neither yield ye your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourselves unto God as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. For sin shall not have dominion over you, for ye are not under the law, but under grace. What then? Shall we sin because we are under, we're not under the law, but under grace? God forbid. Know ye not that to whom ye yield yourselves servants to obey, his servants ye are, to whom ye obey, whether of sin unto death or of obedience unto righteousness. But God be thanked that ye were the servants of sin, but ye have obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which was delivered you. Being then made free from sin, you became the servants of righteousness. I speak after the manner of men because of the infirmity of your flesh. For as ye have yielded your members servants to uncleanness and to iniquity unto iniquity, even so now yield your members servants to righteousness unto holiness. For when ye were servants of sin, ye were free from righteousness. What fruit had ye in those things whereof ye are now ashamed? For the end of those things is death. But now, being made free from sin, ye become the servants to God. Ye have your fruit unto holiness, and the end everlasting life. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Keep your place there, if you would, in that spot. We'll be there in just a minute. We're going to have a special at this time, so you can be seated. Thank you for standing for the reading of the Word this morning. And Brother Derek's going to bring a special, and then we'll get into our message for this morning.
Psalm 36:7 says, "How excellent is thy loving kindness, O God! Therefore, the children of men put their trust under the shadow of thy wings."
Presence, Lord, the King of glory here. You know each thought, each action, hope, anxiety, and fear. How can I hide from thee? Can darkness hide iniquity? Oh, how can I unfaithful be when you are very near to me? When God is near, all the world seems far away. When God is near, every fear is set aside. When God is near, how can I stray? How can I falter? I'll stay upon the altar. I know my God is near. Make me know your presence, Lord, when I feel so alone. You know each thought, each testing pain, the hurt that is unknown. Oh, why can I not see your hand so firmly guiding me? Oh, how can I untrusting be when you are very near to me? When God is near, all the world seems far away. When God is near, every fear is set aside. When God is near, how can I stray? How can I falter? I'll stay upon the altar. I know my God is near. When God is near, all the world seems far away. When God is near, every fear is set aside. When God is near, how can I stray? How can I falter? I'll stay upon the altar. I know my God is near.
Aren't you glad you can know that God is near? Amen. There are people that don't really have a relationship with the Lord to the point where they feel near to Him. Tell you what, if there came a time when I was feeling like I was drawing apart from my wife, I'd do something about that. But how many times do we get away from God and we don't? We just kind of go with it, you know. It seems like it's sometimes can be just not as important. But when God is near, that's when the Christian life is really good. That's when the Christian life is fruitful. When we keep Him close to us, and you know that's a daily thing. We need to see to our Christian lives on a daily basis and do the things that'll keep us close to Him. Amen. Appreciate that song. Appreciate the singing this morning of the congregational songs and your participation this morning. It's been a blessing already. Go ahead and go to Romans chapter 6, if you would. Romans chapter 6. I'm going to begin by going back just a little bit into the last little bit of what we did last week and just kind of beginning there, because we went to verse number 12, and we started there and looked at verse 12 and 13 last week, and I want us to look at what we see, and we're going to begin to build on that as we move forward and get into this, because there's a complete thought here, but we have to take it in pieces and put it together so that we can understand what the apostle here is saying. Verse number 12 talks about being yielded to Christ. Look at what verse 12 says. Let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body, that she should obey it in the lust thereof. Don't yield unto sin is what he is saying there in verse number 13. Neither yield your members as instruments of unrighteousness, but yield yourselves unto God. And so there's some responsibility that you and I have, and that's what we kind of got into last week, was the fact that God has provided the way for us to be able to not yield to sin and to be able to instead say yes to Him by doing a couple things. The first thing He did was He killed our flesh. Our flesh died when He died on the cross. Our flesh died with Him, and we no longer have to be servants unto our flesh. When you get saved, the idea of being a servant to your flesh is no longer a reality in your life unless you make it a reality in your life. See? We are dead to sin, as verse number 11 tells us, and we are alive unto God, it says in verse number 11. And so because of that, we don't have to let sin be the predominant, to be the master in our life. We don't have to let sin control us. We don't have to give into it at every whim simply because that's the way it's always been. The power is there to choose a new master, and we must make that choice. The second thing we looked at was the fact that we must make a choice concerning our master. And it has to do with verse 13 there that talks about yielding. Who are you yielding to? Who are you yielding to in your life? Are you yielding unto your flesh, which basically just desires every whim to be satisfied? And it doesn't matter if it's sinful or not. It desires it. It desires the satisfaction. And no matter what it is, we are doing whatever our flesh tells us to do. Is that where we're yielding? Or are we yielding to God? When you were unsaved, you didn't have the power to not yield unto the flesh, but now you do if you're saved. The power is there. The ability is there. Christ has given us that, and there's a result that comes when we make the choice. Well, there's a result on either side. Yield to sin, we're going to produce unrighteousness. There's no fruit in that. We looked at that this morning, and we looked at that as we read here, it's on down in the passage that talks about there's no fruit in those things wherewith that we used to do that we're now ashamed of. We'll get into that as we go along, but there's nothing good in that. But there's righteousness when we choose to yield to God. So the result of yielding to God rather than sin is that the works that we produce with our life will be pleasing to God, beneficial to the kingdom, rather than being sinful and displeasing. So we've got to make a choice. Let's go on down now to verse number 14. And really today, 14 through 17 is what we're going to predominantly look at. But I want you to see this, especially in this first verse, because this little portion here, verse number 14 to 17, begins with a promise. It's a promise that we have. And all of this section deals with this idea of law versus grace. Law versus grace. And we'll go into a little bit about what that means as we go along here, the law versus grace. But I call that whole subject of the law versus grace, I call it the great dichotomy of the New Testament, because every Christian will probably at some point have a bit of a struggle with the law versus grace. All of us, because of our thinking, because of the way that we naturally think of things, and the way that we are so accustomed, especially if you've not been saved very long, you can still be accustomed to the sinful way that you lived before you were saved, and you can struggle with the idea of law versus grace, and not understanding how that we can live under grace instead of the law. We'll get to that in just a minute. Let's look at this promise first. Look at verse number 14. It says this: "For sin shall not have dominion over you." All right. So as Christians, we're not to give in to the flesh, not to yield to the flesh. We are now to yield to the Spirit. And this promise speaks directly to this thought that sin will not have dominion over us. What does it mean to have dominion? Well, it means that it's Lord, that sin is the Lord. And we are to give in to it. We are to obey it no matter what. And particularly in this society that the Jews were living in, when they had someone that they would recognize as Lord, that person or that thing had full control. We'll look at that as we go as well. Had full control. And they were to submit to it completely. And so he said they had dominion over them. And so he says, sin will not have dominion. Sin's not going to be the boss anymore, is what he says. So we're given a promise that through our salvation and the leading of the Holy Spirit, we no longer are under the dominion of sin. In other words, sin is not the boss. Sin's not the boss. Keep that thought in mind. We know that the unsaved person is under the dominion of sin. Sin rules, and the sinner is subject to it absolutely as a slave. Listen to what one man said. I've got several quotes here from a commentator that wrote on this subject that I want to that will help to kind of drive the point home or illustrate the point that we're making here. This man's name's Clark. He said this. He said, "The Greek word, which we translate servant, properly signifies slave." All right, when you see that word, that we're servants unto something, it's talking about being a slave. "And a slave among the Greeks and Romans was considered as the master's property, and he might dispose of him as he pleases. Under a bad master, the lot of the slave was most oppressive and dreadful. His ease and comfort were never consulted. He was treated worse than a beast, and in many cases, his life hung upon the mere caprice of the master." So the slave in this time, get the picture of this if you would. The slave at that time was nothing more than a possession. And so the possession, the slave that was possessed by that master was under the control of every whim and desire that master would have. He had full, the master had full legal control of his property, and his slaves were his property. A malicious and villainous master could bring about unspeakable things upon the servants that were under his thumb, and often did. Often did. I think in living as we do now, and even in some ways being sheltered from a lot of things, you know, we hear a lot of things today about the times when slavery was in effect here in the United States. And in the culture of the Jews, there was certainly slavery there, and especially when they were under the leadership and authority of another nation, the people would be brought into bondage, into servanthood, and that's what they were, was slaves. And sometimes I think we're insulated a little bit to what that really meant in many cases. And in this sense, the slave, the servant, was at complete mercy to the master, and oftentimes the things that were done in that relationship were completely just atrocities. He continues on. He says, "This state is the state of every poor, miserable sinner. He is the slave of Satan, and his own will, lusts, and appetites are his most cruel taskmasters." Think about that. Think about the fact of being a servant or a slave to sin. No. Think about when you think about that. Think about the damage that sin causes in your life. No. We're talking about being saved. We're talking about saved people, yet being under the willful, voluntary bondage of our sin. That's what he's talking about here. He's saying those who claim the name of Christ but are still allowing sin to be the boss, to be the Lord, to be the master, are bringing into their life great and cruel damage to their life. Sometimes it's physically damaging. It's always spiritually damaging. And so many times, listen, so many times because we don't put away the sin and we continue to let it control us, we bring problems, we bring issues into our life, and we'll want to step back and go, "God, why is this happening to me?" And all we have to do is look inward and find the fact that we are allowing these things to be a part of our life. So he's urging us. The apostle here is urging us: let not sin reign in your body, that you should obey it. Don't yield to sin, but yield through the power of God that's in your life as a result of salvation. Yield to the Spirit. Yield to God, and do His will, and say no to sin. And you say, "Well, I don't have the power for that." If you're saved, you do. You may not think you do, and for years you didn't. Before you were saved. But it's there. It's there upon the authority of the Word of God and the promise of God. The ability is there. So the state of the person who is unsaved is complete subjection to the whims of Satan and to his own lusts. That's the state of someone who is unsaved, for sure. And then we can allow ourselves to be in that state, only it's willingly, because we don't have to, see? But we also see that the state of the saved person is to be different. It is to be different. When Jesus died on the cross, breaking the power of sin, he provided a way that man could be saved by grace through faith. All right? We know the verses, don't we? "For by grace are you saved," what? "Through faith." Yeah, and that not of yourselves, the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. We didn't do anything to get it. That's what grace is. God giving us something that we don't deserve, but freely giving it to us, and that the acronym that's made with the letters of the word grace, God's riches at Christ's expense. We have the ability to have the blessing of just the wonderful things of God, not because we deserved them, not because we earned them, but because God is good. He's gracious, and He said, "If you'll simply turn to me. If you'll simply believe and repent of your sin, I'll save you, not because of what you've done, but by my grace I will save you. And you'll have the benefit of these things. So we are saved by grace, and we're no longer under the law. This is why he said in the last part of verse number 14, for ye are not under the law, but under grace. Because those that are under the law are still in sin. Those that are under the law are what he refers to as being unsaved. But if we're under grace, then we've been saved, and we're under the grace of God. So this means that we're no longer bound by the law in order to please God, but we are now under grace. Listen to what Mr. Clark says about this again. The same word slave is applied to the servants of Christ. So it's not just those who are servants to sin, it's those who are servants to Christ as well. The more forcibly to show that they are their master's property, and that as he is infinitely good and benevolent, therefore his service must be in perfect freedom. Indeed, he exacts no obedience from them, which he does not turn to their eternal advantage. For this master has no self-interest to secure. So if you were going to be a slave, wouldn't you want a good master? Yeah. One that's going to, you know, see to your needs. One that's going to provide those things which you can't provide for yourself. Those that are going to have protection over you. And to see that the things that are good for you are available to you. Now, isn't that good? Wouldn't that be the kind of master you'd want? Because that's the kind of master that God is. And he says, if you will come to me, and if you will accept me, you're no longer under the law, but you're now under grace. And now you are under the, you're still in bondage, but you're now bondage to the Lord. The Apostle Paul said, I am a slave to Christ. In essence, that's what he said. I'm paraphrasing there, but he said, I am in bondage to Christ. And if we're saved, we are his. We've been bought with a price. So we're to serve the master who is truly the master. And we're not going and jumping the fence and going over to the bad master on the other side of the fence and working under him because we like him better. But that's what so many people do when we're saved. Going back to the sin, those old sinful habits, those sinful activities. So the saved are servants of Christ, and Christ is a gracious Savior, is a kind and merciful Lord. All right, so let's go on to verse number 15. Now we've gone from the promise. Now let's go to the question. What then? What then? Shall we sin because we are not under the law, but under grace? All right, so Paul, as he does so oftentimes, he'll be making a point, and then he'll ask a question. And there's this is a pointed question, and we'll look at that as we look at this verse here. He says, shall we sin because we're not under the law but under grace? And so the question here is basically this. It's just what you think. If we are under grace, we're no longer under the obligation of the law. Doesn't that give us a free pass to do whatever we want? Wouldn't that just make it to the point where we can just, all right, yeah, I'm going to be saved so that I can just do whatever. I don't have to be subject to the law anymore. Isn't that what it would be? And he's asking the question, is that not how it would be? Albert Barnes wrote this. He said, the apostle proceeds to notice an objection which might be suggested. If Christians are not under the law, which forbids all sin, but are under grace, which pardons sin, will it not follow that they will feel themselves released from obligation to be holy? Will they not commit sin freely, since the system of grace is one that contemplates pardon and which will lead them to believe that they may be forgiven to any extent? This consequence has been drawn by many professing Christians, and it is well, therefore, the apostle to guard against it. So the question here is he's asking is this. Well, if you're under grace and you're not under the law, Shall we sin? Shall we? Shall we just do whatever we want to do? Notice the answer that he gives in the last part of verse number 15. He uses this term a lot, or this phrase. God forbid. That word, that phrase means perish the thought. Perish the thought. God forbid. That is not the case, is what he's saying. We shall not sin because we're under the law, or because we're under grace and not under the law. Don't even consider that. Verse 16, he explains why. Now, we've used this verse. Now, I want to explain something in this verse. We use it. It is what is known as an abiding principle that we find in verse number 16. Let's read it, and then we'll go from there. Know ye not that to whom ye yield yourselves servants to obey, his servants ye are to whom you obey, whether of sin unto death or of obedience unto righteousness. Now, that is an abiding principle. Who we yield to, we are servants to what we yield to. All right? It works in any area. Now, specifically, the Apostle Paul is referring to salvation. He's referring to the matter of being saved. He said, if you yield unto, to sin, it'll be unto death. If you yield to sin. And that, in other words, if you remain in your sin, it will be unto spiritual death. If you yield to obedience, it will be unto righteousness. And that's the only two options that you have. Now, again, this applies in so many areas in so many ways, but let's use it like it is in context here. He's speaking of salvation. He says, know ye not that to whom ye yield yourselves servants to obey, his servants ye are to whom you obey. So we've used this verse a number of times for different ways, but Paul here is using it in this matter of salvation. And Paul often used the understood things of the day to illustrate, or as illustrations, to help them understand that things that that they might not easily understand otherwise. And this is the way that this is, okay? This is what he's doing. It's as if he's saying, I assume that you're acquainted with the law of servitude. What is the law of servitude? The law of servitude is an important concept because it was something that every Jew or everyone, and speaking even of the Romans, of those that were a part of that culture, they would have known this. They would have understood what the law of servitude was. And he's saying, I would believe you to be aware of what is required in the case of the servant. All right, Mr. Barnes says this, the apostle here refers to voluntary servitude. But where this existed, the power of the master over the time and services of the servant was absolute. The argument of the apostle is the Christian had become the voluntary servants of God and were therefore bound to obey him entirely. Servitude among the ancients, whether voluntary or involuntary, was rigid and gave the master an absolute right over his slave. So here we're talking about, he's saying this, if you're yielding to sin, then you're the servant of sin. If you're yielding to Christ, you're the servant of Christ. All right, that's what the verse is saying. And so he's speaking now to those who claim to be servants of Christ and yet are living in sin. And so he's answering the question that he asked before. Shall we sin because we're under the law? No, because why? Because of the law of servanthood. You're a servant. You're a voluntary servant to Christ. In the law, the provision was made for a person who broke the law. If he was found to be guilty and could not pay restitution, another would pay it for him, and then he who broke the law would go into bondage to the person who paid for the crime that he committed. All right? They didn't have jails in that day. This is what we would consider to be incarceration. They go into bondage. This was the only way in the law that a Hebrew was allowed to put another Hebrew into bondage, okay, into servanthood. So there would be someone there, they would pay the restitution that was required for the person's sin, and then they would go into servanthood. It would last for 6 years, and then they would be freed. Exodus chapter 21 tells us a little bit about this. If you can, real quickly, we're getting close to the end, but turn over to Exodus chapter 21, if you would. Talking about the law of servanthood, law of voluntary servanthood. Exodus 21, beginning in verse number 2, says, "If thou buy an Hebrew servant, 6 years shall he serve, and in the seventh he shall go out free for nothing. If he came in by himself, he shall go out by himself. If he were married, then his wife shall go out with him. If his master have given him a wife, and she have borne him sons and daughters, the wife and her children shall be her master's, and he shall go out by himself. And if the servant," listen, verse number 5, "if the servant shall plainly say, I love my master, my wife, and my children, I will not go out free. Then the master shall bring him unto the judges. He shall also bring him to the door or unto the doorpost, and his master shall bore his ear through with an awl, and he shall serve him forever." By the way, when earrings were worn in the Bible by men, it was because they were in bondage. Think about that. Anyway, that's not where we're focusing, but that's free. So there could be a case where a servant would say, "I'm free to go, but I don't want to go. I love my master. I want to stay with him. He takes care of me. I don't want to go back. Listen, I don't want to go back to that old life that I had. I want to stay here because here's where blessings are. Here's where fruit is. Here's where the things that I need and desire are provided. Here is where I want to be. I'm not going to go back out. I'm going to stay here." You see, this is a picture of the person who has received Christ as their Savior. They voluntarily said, "No, I don't want the world anymore. I don't want the things that I had before. I want to stay here. I want to be Christ. I want to be with Him." And it's a case of voluntary servanthood. It's called a bond slave. You see, his debt, which he could not pay on his own, has been paid. Jesus paid the debt. He's voluntarily accepted the payment for Christ and has yielded to Him, placing himself into bondage to Christ to be His servant here on this earth, relinquishing all bondage to any other. He is to recognize the authority that Christ now has over him and is to give over everything that would be contrary to Christ and only exercise himself in that which is pleasing to his new master. You see, the law of servanthood says this: when you have a master, you're to be totally, completely devoted to that master. I wonder how many of us can say that today. "Well, I'm saved. I've got a new master. But I'm still involved in this. I'm still doing this. And I'm still allowing these things in my life." You see, this is what Paul is talking about. Sin is not to have dominion over us. Sin's not to be the one in charge anymore. Sin's not to be the boss. We're to put away all those things of the flesh, all those things that were displeasing, that were the things that we couldn't but help to do when we were unsaved. But now we have a new master. Now we have a new Lord. And we are to be completely and totally devoted to Him because we have voluntarily become His servant. I wonder today if we can say that. If we can't, maybe today there would be a need to get some things done that would change that. Maybe there'd be a need for coming to before Christ and just getting rid of some things, getting his power. We've said the power is there. We just got to tap into it. Are you willing to give up that thing that's got you under control today? That that one thing, that pet thing, that sin that just kind of keeps coming back and keeps coming back, and no matter how hard you try, you can't get rid of it on your own because you don't have the power. Are you ready to let God help you in that thing and help you to get rid of that thing so you can become completely His servant? Are you ready? Let's have every head bowed and every eye closed today. If you're ready, would you do something about it today? We're going to have a verse of invitation. You don't have to come and tell me what the issue is unless you want to. You don't have to let anybody else know. Just come and deal with God with whatever He's spoken to your heart about. But listen, don't leave here without dealing with it. If God has spoken to your heart, if there's something there that needs to be dealt with, don't leave here without dealing with it. Let him free you today. Let Him free you from that bondage. What is it He says in Scripture? My yoke is easy and my burden is light. Let me be your master, because with me there's rest. You'll find rest unto your souls. Let Him take that bondage of sin off you, that heavy weight that's keeping you from being what you should be, and keeping you from accomplishing what God wants you to accomplish and from bearing fruit in your life. It's keeping you from being close to God as you desire to be. Let Him throw that thing off of you and submit yourself to Him who cares for your soul. Father, bless now this invitation. Please, just please work, Lord. You know what needs to be done. Lord, I don't. I'm just preaching the message You gave me. But Lord, it's very possible that somebody here has needed to hear this. And because there are things that they're dealing with that they just can't seem to get rid of, that are dragging their Christian life down and make them ineffective for You. But Lord, I pray that You'd help us to realize it doesn't have to stay that way. Lord, do in us what needs to be done today. Lord, help us to submit to You. Not just hold off. I'll wait a little longer. Try a little more myself. Lord, help us to just give in to You and let Your power do what needs to be done today. Bless the invitation now in Jesus' name. Amen. Stand with me, please, if you would. We're not going to take a long time of invitation. If you need to come, you come. You need to deal with things, deal with them now. Don't let pride keep you where you're at. Don't let self-reliance keep you where you're at. The power is in the Lord. If you're saved, it's there for you. Listen, if you're not saved, come today and get that settled. The power is available. Let God help you. Jesus paid it all to Him. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Lord, now indeed I find Thy power and Thine alone can change the leper's spots and melt the heart of stone. Jesus paid it all.
Jesus paid it all. All to Him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow.
Let me encourage you this morning. You don't have to let sin have control. Too many Christians, and I'm not saying this because I believe that there are people in our midst that are just waist deep in sin. That's not why I'm saying this. Because God gave me a message, that's why I'm saying it. You don't have to be controlled by sin. God has freed us from that. And if you're saved, you have the power. Not you, but Christ in you. Your position in Christ is such that you are no longer in bondage to sin. You are His, and you don't have to say yes to sin anymore. Now, it's not an easy thing. Especially if you got saved later in life. it takes some effort and some work, but the more you do it, the easier it gets. And when you see the benefits of it and the rewards of it, it gets easier even still. Because you see those wonderful things that are possible because you're putting away sin out of your life. But you don't have to be enslaved. Let God help you get rid of that sin that's in your life. If there's something there, and you know it, I have no idea. You and God know. If there's something there, let Him help you get rid of it because He's given you the power to do it. Thank you so much for coming this morning, for being a part of this service. It's a blessing, and it's been a blessing here this morning. We're going to go ahead and be dismissed in a chorus. You got a chorus ready? We'll go ahead and be dismissed in a chorus this morning, and then we'll dismiss here, and we will reconvene at Main Park. All right? So if you have any questions about how to get there, please let someone know. There's many here that can tell you how to get there, but I hope you come and join us, and we're gonna take a little portion out of this scripture and just look at that this afternoon at the park. And I hope it'll be a blessing to you. It's something that God showed to me and has been a blessing to me, and I hope it'll be a blessing to you there. But come and join us and have some lunch and some fellowship and enjoy some time out at the park. Brother Isaiah, is there anything you need before we go? Okay. If you're willing to help with some things, there's a grill that I think still needs to be loaded up and a couple of things like that to get out to the park. If you can lend a hand for that, that would be great. See Isaiah about that. But we will see you out there, and we will spend the afternoon out there together. All right. Go ahead and come on, Brother Derek.
Number 236, if you need it, whosoever will may come. We'll just sing the chorus.
Whosoever will, send the proclamation over vale and hill. 'Tis the loving Father calls the wanderer home. Whosoever will may come.
Whosoever will, we'll see you at the park.